Welcome to Public Health On Call, a new podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. Our focus is the novel coronavirus. I'm Josh Sharfstein, a faculty member at Johns Hopkins and also a former secretary of Maryland's Health Department. Our goal with this podcast is to bring evidence and experts to help you understand today's news about the novel coronavirus and what it means for tomorrow. If you have questions, you can email them to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes. Today, Stephanie Desmond talks to Emily Gurley and Brooke Jarrett, two Johns Hopkins epidemiologists who are at the forefront of efforts to control community transmission of the novel coronavirus. We hear about their on-the-ground efforts to trace the disease and why it is a key to slowing its spread. Let's listen.
Thanks for joining me.
We're happy to be here.
Glad to be here.
Today, we're going to talk about strategies to control community transmission of COVID. Right now, everybody's staying home, and that is sort of one of the bluntest tools we have to control community transmission. But there are other ways to do this, and one of them is to really investigate each case and see where it came from and see where it may have been spread. Emily, can you tell me a little bit about how you do that?
So most people by now have probably heard the term contact tracing. Contact tracing refers to a public health strategy to limit community transmission, whereby you find people in the community who are infected and you get them to stay home while they're infectious so they don't infect anyone else. So the first step in that is identifying cases. So people who have infections, you identify them as quickly as possible and you ask them to stay home while they are sick. Next, you identify everyone that they have had contact with and could have infected. And you ask all of those people to stay home and not have contact with anyone else for 14 days. That's called a self-quarantine. When you ask a person who is already sick to stay home and not have contact with anyone else, that's called isolation. Quarantine is a very important step here because you want to have people already at home if and when they do become infectious. That's the best way that we know of to prevent community transmission. And this disease in particular is very tricky, right? Because many people who are infected will never develop signs and symptoms. So even if they don't become sick, they still should stay home so they don't transmit to anyone else. And many people who do become sick are going to be infectious before they know they're sick. So it's the identification of contacts and asking them to self-quarantine that's really central to getting this to work.
That's a really big ask, right? You say, oh, so-and-so, your friend is sick, you had contact with them, now you should stay home for 2 weeks. How do people respond? Brooke?
Yeah, so some people are very compliant when you ask them to stay home for 14 days. They have the privilege and capacity to stay home for 14 days. Perhaps they've already gone out and had extra money or at least a little bit of buffer to buy extra food so that they don't have to go out, or they've already had and know how to set up grocery delivery, or even have Wi-Fi that's necessary to order groceries. Perhaps they have a really strong social support and community around them, neighbors, friends, family who can bring them food, but that's certainly not the case for everybody. We definitely face a lot of challenges, and I don't think it's specific to Baltimore necessarily, but there are people who need to go to work, who are resistant to stay home if they are feeling totally fine because they're already living paycheck to paycheck. Or as we know, a large proportion of people have lost their jobs over the past several weeks. So there are definitely folks that are resistant. And then there's also sometimes when you ask someone to stay home, I think some of the best work that we can do as contact tracers are set them up and create an environment where they can. And so that means policies and programs that can help people pay their rents or avoid eviction, help out with utility bills, or to even bring food from food pantries.
So Emily, how do you do this? You go door to door? I guess that's not really happening right now.
No. So the idea of contact tracing works for many types of infectious diseases, but the way you do it is a little bit different for each one. So for this pandemic, most folks are not going door to door. And there are a few reasons. One, we have to be really quick in finding people. So often a telephone call is quicker than going door to door. Second, if you go to find people who could be infected, you have to use the appropriate protection, such as masks, gloves, and perhaps other types of PPE. And we're still at a stage where we're reserving those for our frontline healthcare workers. We don't have enough for public health yet. We could get to a place where we do try to go door to door or find people in the community. Some people don't have reliable phone numbers. Sometimes you can't find someone by phone and you really want to go out and look for them. We're not doing that right now, but there may be a time and place where that becomes more important.
Are people reluctant to share the names of their contacts?
Sometimes.
Yeah, that can be a challenge.
Sure. For a number of reasons, generally, could be due to stigma. People don't want others to know that they're sick. It could be due to privacy reasons. Sometimes people don't want you to know who their contacts are. Some people just may not feel comfortable sharing their private information with others. Maybe Brooke has some additional thoughts on this or can share some of her experiences.
Yeah, well, I would say something that I've been thinking about a little bit is that we certainly get varying degrees of skill when it comes to contact tracers. And while some parts of it are definitely trainable, I think that you get a lot more done if you can connect with someone over the phone. Sometimes some of the first immediate responses that we get are, how do I know you're from the city health department? Because unfortunately, there's a lot going around about scams, even for instance, some of the financial aid that is going out, and there's scams around that, and you know, or social security things happening when you pick up your phone. I'm surprised, honestly, that anyone picks up the phone when we're trying to call them. I'm grateful that they are. But yeah, making that human connection with someone and saying, you know, I'm here to check up on you. We want to know how you're doing. We want to protect you. We want to protect your family. We want to protect our community. And if you can make that connection, I think people are much more willing to disclose who they were in contact with because they recognize that you're not just there to collect data from them. You're part of an effort, and that effort is this larger hope that eventually we're going to dig ourselves out of this hole, and sometime soon.
So one of the things that I haven't told our listeners is that you are doing some of this work in Baltimore City, and that Emily, you're helping to sort of lead some efforts in this realm. Could you tell me a little bit about that?
Sure. Well, at the school, we're doing a number of things. One is trying to put together some recommendations for cities, some considerations around contact tracing and best practices so that folks have some guidance as they work to build out this public health function. Unfortunately, public health is typically very neglected. And so for cities and states who really want to do this well and at a scale that will be required to respond effectively to COVID-19, they're going to have to build out teams. So we're providing some guidance there. And we're also going to help with developing training materials that will be available, publicly available for anyone. And we think specifically one place they may be used first is in New York State, where efforts are already underway to hire and train a whole army of public health workers.
Yeah, I wanted to ask about that scale. To get this done with the pandemic like this, you would think you'd need a lot of contact tracers.
You'd think that and you'd be right. Yeah. There's no magic number. Mm-hmm. And really it depends on how many cases you have.
You had told me previously about a South Korean study. It looked at how they traced contacts and found, I believe it was 30 cases. Could you tell me a little bit about that?
Yeah, sure. So when we talk about contact tracing and we say you want to find people's contacts, let's delve a little bit into what that means. So This means people who we think have had a potentially infectious contact. So potentially infectious contacts are very close contacts. Perhaps you live with someone or you've had close physical contact with that person. We also talk about, you know, if you've been close to someone, maybe you didn't have physical contact with them, but you shared a cubicle with them, you shared a meal with them, you were in a situation, you know, for longer than just a few minutes with someone where you were within 6 feet of that person. Those are what we call close contacts. You know, within 6 feet, why do we talk about within 6 feet? Well, generally we know that if you cough or sneeze or you're talking and you're laughing, respiratory droplets from your mouth can be projected around 6 feet. So if you're beyond that, you're probably in a safe zone. Okay. So we ask cases, who are all the people who you've had this type of contact with in two time periods? One, during your illness, because you're infectious during your illness. We also ask about the 2 to 3 days before your illness, because as we know with this disease in particular, you can be infectious before you know you're sick. So you can imagine in the course of a day, of course it depends on the person, but there could be a lot of people that you have contact with that you, you know, are in proximity to. And when we think about people who've had a lot of contacts, it gets overwhelming. But this study from Korea did a very nice job at setting out, you know, what the risk looks like among different types of contact. So they followed all the contacts they could find, close, you know, people who spent some time nearby, known COVID-19 patients. So they had 30 patients and they listed all of their contacts. Those contacts totaled over 2,000 people. So if you're thinking about contact tracing, that's daunting. That is a daunting number, just 30 cases, and you need to follow more than 2,000 people. So they followed up with all those contacts to see who got infected, right? That's what we want to know. They found 12 infections. So 12 people were infected. Among those 12, 9 were household members of the 30 initial cases that they were investigating. So what does that tell us? That tells us that while it's possible to infect someone with many different types of contact, not all of those contacts are at equal risk of infection. Typically, people who have the closest contact to you as the patient are the ones at highest risk. And so when we think about contact tracing generally, this can take off some pressure. So in this study in Korea, only about 190 of those contacts were household members. So one way to think about that would be if you only followed up with those 190 people who lived in the house with those contacts, you know, you would have identified 75% of all the transmission. So when we have scarce resources and this huge need, it can be helpful, you know, to think about strategies to really focus and target our efforts to have the greatest impact.
So we are getting close to 1 million cases in the United States. And it makes me wonder, is it too late to be utilizing this strategy?
Too late for what would be my response? Too late to stop the transmission of SARS coronavirus 2? Yes. Our opportunity to do that ended a long time ago. Is it too late to have a public health impact? I would say no. Even in places where you have clear ongoing community transmission, this can still have an impact just because of the multiplier. So each individual case without any intervention can infect 2 to 3 people, we think. And then each of those can infect 2 to 3 more people, and each of those 2 to 3 more. So if you prevent just one case in that kind of scenario, you're preventing dozens of cases that would have occurred otherwise just a few weeks from now. So it can feel overwhelming, but there's always, I think, a reason to start. The second thing I would say is that although we're not going to get rid of this disease, we're taking all these very blunt population-wide control measures now, telling people to stay home, work from home. And what we're doing right now is a huge effort and an attempt to bring transmission down. So if we bring transmission down, that means that we're going to have fewer new cases occurring and we'll be able to respond, you know, even better with contact tracing, right? It gets down to a more manageable number where we can really wrap our arms around it and try to control it. It becomes a more tractable problem once we've taken these other measures really to drive the numbers down.
Emily Gurley, Brooke Jarrett, thank you both so much for joining me. This was a fascinating conversation.
Thank you.
It's our pleasure.
Thank you for listening to Public Health on Call, a new podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. Please send questions to be covered in future podcasts to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. This podcast is produced by Josh Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Lamare Morales. Audio production by Niall Owen McCusker and Spencer Greer, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Thank you for listening.